Thank you for having me. My name is Amir. I am CEO and Chief Parakeet at Paracosm. And we are a 3D mapping and mixed reality company. And our name, Paracosm, it's actually a word that means imaginary world, like paranormal and cosmos. And that's what we do, is we create a parallel version of reality, except digital. And what I wanted to do today is kind of give a little, you know, not so much talk about Paracosm, but I was going to give a little primer on mixed reality, which is sort of the one of the big frontier technologies that 3D mapping is enabling. So is everyone here, or is anyone not familiar with augmented or mixed reality? Has anyone heard of it, not heard of it? Okay, so we'll kind of, I'll just kind of start at the top. And what mixed reality is, I'll do like a little kind of industry overview here. What mixed reality is the ability, this is from a Florida-based company called Magic Leap. Mixed reality is the ability to insert 3D virtual objects into the same physical space as us. And here you can see it's a solar system hanging out on someone's desk. There's a little robot guy underneath. And so this is from, as I said, there's a company Magic Leap working on this. And there's actually many other companies doing similar work. And we'll talk a little more about it. There's also, you may have heard of the Microsoft HoloLens, which is a headset that will allow you to interact with holograms in your living room or at work. Very cool technology. And you know, you can imagine one of the use cases they show is somebody at home and you're building your own very own Minecraft fortress in your living room. It's pretty amazing work. At CES, you know, a company called Daiquiri announced a product in collaboration with Intel that is a construction helmet that is also has mixed reality capability that will allow workers in the field, on construction sites and factories, be able to kind of see an augmented, enhanced version of reality. You know, perhaps they can see through a wall, there's like a heat camera that can overlay things, or they can receive instructions in the field as they go along. So this is like a very revolutionary concept that has never before been possible, right? This is the ability to have the full power of the digital world, everything that, you know, computers are good at, now completely living in the physical space we're working and playing in. So that's mixed reality. We're mixing physical virtual reality. And, you know, the fundamental technology for virtual reality and mixed reality has been around since the, you know, pretty much since 1968, but why hasn't it come to market until, well, it's still not to market, right? We're still, maybe sometime this year we'll see this to market. And that's kind of what we'll touch on a little bit right now is, you know, we'll go through some of the challenges the industry has faced, how we're solving it, and what different companies are up to here. So fundamentally, when we want to mix virtual objects, holograms, if you will, into the physical space with us, there's a few considerations that we need to take into account. One is the actual display of the object needs to have correct perspective and occlusion. And what I mean by that is, if you look at this example, it's from an iPhone app you can download from a company just called Augment. You know, they have a very nice app where they can stick virtual objects, in this case it's a little troll, onto the desk with you. But you can notice there's no, this little character is not standing on the desk. There's no perspective like you would expect from a video game. You can see he's not behind my cup of coffee there. So it's very important with blending physical and virtual reality that the virtual objects behave as a physical object would in real life, meaning when it's closer, it's bigger. When it's further away, it's tinier. If it's behind a desk, it should be hidden by the desk. The other major problem we want is what some people call world locking, which means when I drop a virtual object, perhaps it's a like the Minecraft fortress or the you know, someone working at a factory, I actually want the object to stay put in physical reality. So if I were to drop a virtual couch here next to me, I want to be able to run a lap around the building, come back, have the couch still be there as if it was a real object. This is another major problem that mixed reality has only recently been able to solve. And then finally, my physical objects should have shadows, should have physics, and, you know, if it's a character, should have path planning, right? If I have a virtual goblin running around, it should respect where the furniture is, it should cast a shadow, and it should be able to interact with the real world. Otherwise, we're not really doing a good job blending our reality. So these are all major problems, and they continue to be major problems that are only now really recently being able to be solved. And what Paracosm does is we feel we've developed a very unique solution to some of these problems with developing 3D maps. So what our big aha moment is that a 3D map of your environment effectively acts as a like a translation layer between the physical reality and the virtual reality. So you can see here we have a real world room. If we can magically and perfectly digitize it into a 3D model, all of a sudden, we have the answer to almost all of those problems that we saw previously. We now know the shape of the room. We now know the size of the room. We can cast shadows. We can do physics. Effectively, it's a translation layer that now the virtual objects can interact with the real world. So what's enabled this are this new wave, of technologies that are only really now becoming viable. The first being 3D sensing, which everyone's familiar with the Microsoft Kinect. And, you know, Intel RealSense was a big announcement at CES this year, and there's some other cameras that are very interesting. And effectively, these are devices that use lasers, infrared lasers, you know, invisible to naked eye, to figure out a depth perception. So what they generate is an image just like normal, but for every pixel, it uses a laser to determine the distance to the object. And it turns out this is a very critical piece to developing a 3D understanding of reality. So these depth sensors are now packaged with next generation mobile processors. And all of a sudden, we start to have these devices like Google's Project Tango, which was another big announcement at CES, it's going to be launching this summer, that can now take next generation mobile GPUs, mobile ARM processors, combine it with 3D depth sensing to start to solve these mixed reality problems. Now we finally have enough processing power combined with the sensing power to understand the shape of our room, to render objects with correct perspective, and to understand using 3D sensing, you know, where, let me see, this is supposed to be a little animation here. I don't know if it'll play or not. But you can see we have a little puppy sitting on this guy's lap. Because now that we know the shape of the room, we can start to place virtual objects. We have another interesting set of technology coming our way, which are headsets, which now allow us to view these holograms free from a tablet, just like the Microsoft HoloLens. Epson is making a headset. There's another company called ODG that is making a headset. And what these devices do is now they allow us to view these holograms hands-free so that I can use my hands to interact with the real world. So we have a wave of really fascinating technology coming that's going to finally allow us to bridge this gap. So how does this all come together? Well, this is, you know, enough tell. Let's take a quick look at this in action here. So I'm just gonna show you this video here I'll walk you through this. So what we have, I don't see my mouse, but is the ability now to create a 3D map of the real world. So what Paracosm has developed is software that can take video from these 3D sensing devices and aggregate it into a 3D model of the space you're in. And this is the basis of now allowing physical and virtual reality to blend. This is our office in Florida. It's 5,000 square feet. We spent half an hour walking around with, you know, these Microsoft Kinect style sensors. And what we do is we process the video and generate this dimensionally accurate 3D model that contains all of the structural information of the scene. We have all the geometry, the full shape of the room, and now, just like a virtual character can navigate a video game level, we've now turned reality into a video game level. And what you see here, when we fire a virtual ball, it has a shadow on the couch, it bounces off of the couch. We can have characters running around the space with us, casting shadows, jumping on the furniture, following a path. You can even see, you know, again, ball bouncing. It works anywhere in the office because once you have a model, anything I do in a video game, I can now bring it into the world with me. So we've effectively crossed the divide between physical and virtual reality. This tablet running this app sees reality the same way as your video game sees a video game level. Characters jump around the couch. It even works outdoors. We can even bounce some balls off the outside world. And then what's even more exciting, let's see here, is the ability to start to completely change the paradigm of what it means to be in physical or virtual reality. You see here, we open up a portal in our office wall to a fully virtual world. But what's really exciting with mixed reality is there's no divide between the physical and virtual world. We can actually have the characters jump into our office right alongside us. So this is what Paracosm does, is we develop these 3D models, which I'll take a minute here to show you one in detail. There's these 3D models where we can grab full measurements. I'll just drop a tape measurement tool here to show you that you can take a tape measurement from these 3D models and it would be the same measurement as in the real world. These models, which are just gathered by just walking around the room, taking a video, become a full representation of reality that now I can use this to, you know, just like you saw, we can, hey, let's play a game. You know, we can, now that we've aligned all of our physical and virtual worlds together. Oh, here we go. So now my friend's apartment. When we hold up an iPad, we can now drop in little alien creatures. You can chase them through the apartment and try to battle aliens that live alongside the space right near you. Portals open up in the walls. Pretty amazing stuff. We can drop in. And here's a nice little illustration where, let me fast forward. In our same apartment, you can see we have King Kong living in the apartment with us. And again, what's happening is the 3D model, King Kong lives in the virtual world, but what we've effectively done is we hide the 3D model we created and physical virtual reality again blends seamlessly. We can even use this to play some really interesting games where we can, you know, pick out individual objects in the real world, turn them all into, you know, interactive elements, and even kind of, I don't know if, you know, I know there's no sound, but I'll see YouTube video playing in the background. We can come see audio later, but my audio is, there's that YouTube thing going on. In this demo, we had each object in the room. Well, yeah, can we do audio? Yep. Let's do that. Let me see here. There we go. We just map. Each object maps to musical instrument. And now you can actually turn your room into an instrument just by tapping on each object. All right. So yeah, that's your augmented mixed reality primer for the evening. I'd love to take any any questions.
Very interesting. The mapping part itself, when you walk around the space, is that something that anyone can do? Eventually, people will be able to. Is there a science to doing that?
Exactly. So what we do specifically is we develop the software that enables the mapping to occur. But the idea is all those 3D sensors that we looked at earlier are going to start. The intent of these devices is to be embedded in the next generation of mobile phones and tablets. So, you know, Intel RealSense is a 3D sensor that's going to be on your phone. Google Tango is announced to be shipping this summer. 2 years ago, Apple purchased the original Microsoft Kinect company. So the theory is, within the next 1 to 2 years, 3D sensors are going to be on your phone, on your tablet, and when you grab a video from that, you're going to use our software to develop the 3D maps.
Okay, fantastic. And the assets, like the dinosaur, King Kong, all those things, so where do they come from, and how do you work them in?
So the assets, it's similar to the live-like presentation. You need a 3D artist and a game developer. But the idea is, with tools like this, the same way you would develop a video game, you still make the same assets, the same artwork. It's just you're designing a video game where the video game level is reality, is your living room. And it has some interesting implications because everyone's living room is different. So you're going to need to have tools that automatically sort of, instead of having it be a static environment, you would say, hey, I'm making an experience designed for living rooms. So when I recognize a couch, I'm going to behave this way. When I recognize a kitchen, I'm going to behave that way.
So besides gaming, is there any other sort of enterprise applications? Like, for example, with Paracosm, I understand the Microsoft one, but are you focused only on gaming? Using RealSense or Project Tango together, or are you looking into the architects scanning a space and being able to design?
That's actually our first market, yes. So the question is the adoption of this technology, are we going to see it come to consumers first or enterprise first? And I personally believe this is going to be an enterprise first technology for many reasons. First being, a lot of this hardware is going to be very expensive. Like the HoloLens, when it hits the market, will be a few thousand dollars. And you know, the killer use cases right now are enterprise. It's going to be engineering firms, construction firms, and architects who need to 3D map their spaces and visualize it. It's going to be companies that are, you know, like that are customers of Daiquiri, where they have factories and they want their factories mapped, and then the workers in the factories to be able to have like overlays and instructions and training when they interact with the factory. So I think the next 1 to 3 years, we're going to see this adopted by those markets, and then it'll diffuse to consumer applications a little more slowly.
One of the standard methods of building three-dimensional models is using Unity. How do you see yourself in Unity? Are you a competitor? Are you going to work with them? How do you fit together?
So that's a really good question. The question is about Unity, which is Unity is a 3D game engine that people use to develop games. So what's happening right now in the industry is very interesting. Unity has actually become the de facto standard for developing these applications. So Unity is almost the environment that you develop the applications in. And everyone's doing it because it compiles to every platform. And so the idea is Unity allows you to take in your, let's just call it your video game level, your art assets, and your programming all together. So what effectively Paracosm does is we write software that gives you the 3D map that you need to import into Unity. So you actually need to use Unity, well, you don't need to, but it's best to use Unity to develop these experiences. But how do you bring the experience into the reality? That's, you have to import the 3D map that we hand you.
If your 3D environment changes on you, can you pick it up with that?
Yeah, so that's, yeah, what happens if you scan like your living room and someone moves the couch? So that's a good question. Right now, we're just like pretending that's not going to happen. But you know, it's the software is still so new that it's there's really two. So I mean, diving into the academic R&D details, there's two fundamental methods to do 3D mapping. You can do something like real time on the fly, and it's just continuously updating. Or you can do it like we do it offline and ahead of time. And the difference, you know, there's trade-offs to each method. We're trying to figure out a way to get the best of both worlds. You know, I think the answer is you're going to need to do both, because if I want to, you know, have a zombie chase me through my house, I need to have a map of my house ahead of time so that, you know, the zombie knows where to start, where to end. But if furniture is moving, I need something real time to adapt to that change. So the real answer is we're going to need, you need two components of the system interacting together, and that's going to take us a little bit longer to build. But yeah, it's coming. And there's also some other really cool stuff. You know, when you imagine, it's not just limit, you know, I don't touch on it here, but this exact same principle applies to like robotics. Imagine you have your whole house mapped, and now you can tell your robot where to go in your house. Hey, vacuum here, vacuum there. That's a good question. So it's so that's a really tough one. But the idea is, you know, this all, not just all this hardware, you know, the 3D sensing and the tablets, but our software is so new. We spent 3 years developing this, and it's just now, we're just now releasing it to our early adopters, that to be able to have a dynamic experience where anyone can scan their living room and zombies are chasing you, dynamically adapting to the environment, is tricky. It's going to require us the ability, we're going to have to develop a new layer of software that is, you know, intelligent enough to be dynamic and say, hey, okay, I recognize the couch, I know what I'm going to do. Or, you know, I recognize I want to hide behind a wall or something. So we're going to need to build another layer on top of it, which is why we're approaching industrial applications first, because a factory is not going to change. You know, we can work with the factory, we can work with the architecture firm and sort of set up the experience for a fixed environment, and it's going to be a little while till we're able to be dynamic, like you're saying, for consumers, and everyone's house is different. If that answers your question. Oh, I'll be hanging around. You can ask me stuff. How long until this is good enough to create our assets? So the short answer is, well, we can scan objects today. We could scan a room today, and it's the same file format. So why can't we just scan this and have this be a virtual reality model? Why can't we scan this couch, have it be 3D? And the answer is, that works today. We have that working. But the long answer is, the quality of the model is still not there yet. It's still, people, when you look at, you might have remembered from the video, it doesn't look that great yet. So it's going to be a few more years until we have the software to make it look like pretty, like photorealistic. And we can absolutely scan it and it have it be a 3D asset, but the aesthetic quality is not up to standard yet. So people see it and they don't like it. So we need more work on that. And there's also a technical issue. When you do a scan, you end up with a very high density model. The way 3D scanners work, they see points in space. So you would end up with a model with maybe a million polygons. And to be an art asset, it needs about 10. So it's about two or three orders. The 3D models created by scanning are about 2 to 3 orders of magnitude too dense to be used as assets yet.
Awesome.
All right. Thank you.